Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. Paul there, he celebrates the fact that God has justified and reconciled sinners through the death of one man, Jesus Christ, and he can therefore be counted on to save them from the coming wrath. So we see that in 5, 1 to 11. And then in chapter 5, verses 12 to 21, we've been camped here for a while, and we're going to be here for a good part of today. So that's just how it is. I think there's a lot of things here that need to be said. And in chapter 5, 12 to 21, Paul's making the point, as I see it, that it's not as strange as it may seem that one man can have such a significant effect on so many people. As he says in chapter 5, verses 1 to 11, that God has justified and reconciled his enemies through the death of one man, that's a tremendous effect. And then in 5, 12 through 21, as I see it, he's making that point that it's not that strange. There's an analog in the case of Adam. See, just as there existed a death-producing connection between Adam and his own, so there exists a life-producing connection between Christ and his own. As I said last week, Paul says, at least as I see it, Paul says that Adam is analogous to Christ in that Adam's sin brought the divine death penalty on all of his accountable descendants. Though each person earns his own death sentence by sinning, as Adam did, we receive from Adam a bentness or a proclivity to sin that makes him a cause of our sinning. And it's in that indirect but very real sense that we were all made sinners by Adam's sin, as he says in 5:19, and that death reigned through him, as he says in 5:17. Now, I side with the scholars who think Paul is not discussing the case of what we call the unaccountable, infants and those with mental defects that are sufficient to prevent them from appreciating aspects of God and creation and that kind of thing. I side with those who think Paul's not discussing those, but nevertheless, I shared with you how I think one should understand the death of those unaccountable individuals. I gave you my understanding of that, what I think of that. As is true of Christians, you know that our death is not a death of condemnation, because Paul says in Romans 8:1, there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ, so our death is not a death of condemnation. So as is true of Christians, the deaths of the unaccountable are not an act of divine condemnation, but are merely a non-punitive consequence of mankind having become mortal after Adam's sin. Now, when we sin, our mortality ceases to be a non-punitive consequence, and it becomes a sentence. You see, at that point, we are condemned to die and no longer simply fated to die. Now, when we ended, I was explaining that there are different ideas on how this predisposition to sin that's traceable to Adam, how it's been transmitted. So that's where I want to pick back up. Now, there's a bit more that I need to say in this chapter. I'm going as through it as quickly as I think is reasonable, but there's just a lot of stuff to say here. So I'll spend as much time as I think I need to, and then maybe by the end of the class we'll move into chapter 6, but we'll see. Now, whether this predisposition to sin is transmitted to Adam's descendants, whether that's done socially or psychologically or biologically, that's debated. But however it's transmitted, our sin, and hence our death sentence, is traceable to Adam. That's what makes him analogous to Jesus. You see, that's the point that Paul is making, is that the fact that Christ has such a tremendous effect is not as strange as it may seem, because there's an analog in Adam. Okay? Yes. Yes. So that's a question. I'll say something about that. That raises a deep question. But in some way, shape, or form, you see that our sin. He is a cause of our sin. I mean, that's how I read what Paul is saying. That's the whole point of keeping the analogy. Listen, there are different possibilities. I think we probably are, yes. Yes. Okay. Yeah, well, we're fallen, but let me talk about the three different possibilities, and then maybe some of that will come to light. Okay? All right, so there are different ideas on how is this transmitted. You know, there are different concepts of how is this proclivity or bentness to sin that is from Adam, how is it transmitted to his descendants? Because it is tied to Adam. That's what I was talking about last week. Somehow he is a cause of our sinning. Okay, so how is it now? Social idea, I think I mentioned this last week right when the bell rang, that idea is that Adam, when he tasted sin, he gave it a dominance in his life. It's like an addiction. And so every child then born is born into a sin-corrupt, sin-twisted, sin-addicted family and society, and is then bent by that. So that's this, you know, that some would say that that's how it's transmitted. It is transmitted because sin has come in. The society and the family is sin-addicted, sin-corrupted, sin-twisted. You're born into that and you're bent by that. Okay, the psychological idea is that when man became mortal, as a consequence of Adam's sin, he became inclined to overcome the resulting anxiety and insecurity by asserting his independence and his dominance. This is an idea of Reinhold Niebuhr's, is that once we became mortal, well, this creates insecurity, this creates anxiety, and we try to assert control and independence, which inclination to do that leads to sinning. So that's that. But the dominant idea, the idea that is thought by most people, and I think is probably correct, is that it's the biological idea, which was expressed in that quote that I gave you from Cranfield, which I chose not to repeat here. But it's that Adam's very nature was corrupted when he turned from God, and that this corrupt nature is part of what's inherited from one's parents. Now you say, well, we're in the image of God. Yes, we're in the image of God, but we're fallen. You see, so that doesn't negate that we're in the image of God. But there's this idea. Now let me read you a quote from Adam Harwood. He's a good representative of this idea of the biological idea. This is from his book, The Spiritual Condition of Infants. He says, the argument of this book is that infants inherit from Adam a sinful nature, but not guilt. The sinful nature that infants inherit will eventually result in their becoming guilty by knowingly committing acts of sin. It is at that point that people immediately fall under God's judgment and condemnation. So that's consistent. What I'm telling you is that somehow Adam is a cause. Now, how he transmits that proclivity to sin is a matter of debate. But this idea that he does it biologically, and that something is, there's a corrupt nature that we inherit, you see, that then leads us, but we're not condemned when we're born, though we have this corrupt nature. It's only when that nature manifests itself in sinning do we then come under judgment, so that our mortality then is converted to a death sentence, rather than simply something that's a consequence of our mortality. Okay, so that's that idea. Now here's what Moo says. I almost took this out, but I wanted you to see it. Moo says, why do people so consistently turn from good to evil of all kinds? I mean, that is a good question, isn't it? Why is the batting average 1,000? Why is it that every person sins? Okay, Moo says, why do people so consistently turn from good to evil of all kinds? Paul affirms in this passage that human solidarity in the sin of Adam is the explanation. And whether we explain this solidarity in terms of sinning in and with Adam, or because of a corrupt nature inherited from him, doesn't matter at this point. On any view, this, the biblical explanation for universal human sinfulness, appears to explain the data of history and experience as well as, or better than, any rival theory. It does seem to be something that requires an explanation. Why every person sins? You know, and this is the idea that he's tracing this to Adam, saying that as Adam had a tremendous effect on people, so Christ as the analog, it shouldn't surprise you that he has tremendous effect on people. Now, just how is it that we are blameworthy and culpable for our sinning despite being heirs of the fallenness introduced by Adam? That was your question, I think. You see, how is it that we are blameworthy and culpable for our sinning when we are all heirs of a corruption or a fallenness that we've inherited from Adam? But it's nowhere explained. You see, this is just one of these things you don't get where you can turn and say, this is how these things fit together. Paul seems content simply to hold these two truths in tension. That you are responsible, you are culpable, you are guilty, and yet Adam is a cause. He's all right. Let me read to you what James Dunn says in his book, A Theology of Paul the Apostle. I just thought this was gets at it. He says the issue of, he's talking about Paul's discussion in Romans chapter 7 that we'll eventually get to. He says the issue of personal responsibility, Paul tried to resolve by depicting sin as a power which fully masters the fleshly eye, 7:14, without really denying the eye's part in the evil it does or exculpating its failure to do the good. So it just seems that Paul is content to hold the tension that you are culpable, you are responsible, and Adam is a cause. So that's all I know to say about that. It seems clear to me that Paul is saying that Adam had a tremendous effect on all people. And the way I understand that is how I've tried to explain it. That he transmits corruption in some way, shape, or form. And because of that, he is a cause of our sin. So he's the analog of Christ. He has this tremendous negative effect on all who are his own. Well, Jesus has a tremendous positive effect on all who are his own. That's the point I think Paul's making. But in that, he's loaded so much theology in just these little, you know, so we're spending however long trying to unpack some of it. And again, I just give it to you the way I understand it. This is something you can go and look, and there are different ways to skin this cat. I give you the way I skin it. And you weigh that and you think, okay, that makes sense or it doesn't. But I think that's an important thing, and the question you raise is an important one. How do these things work? And I wish I could turn to something and give you something that's clearer than that. Now let me go back to Romans 5, because there's more to be said here. To appreciate the point that I think Paul is making in verses 13 and 14, one must appreciate the distinction between sin and transgression. You had asked me about this some weeks ago. To understand the point that I think he's making in verses 13 and 14, you have to understand the distinction between sin and transgression. They're not synonymous. See, sin and transgression are not synonymous. As I've said before, the Mosaic law, the Mosaic covenant, the laws that are associated with that covenant, the Mosaic covenant included the grandest and the most complete expression to that time of God's moral requirements. But moral requirements did not begin when God gave the law to Moses on Mount Sinai. Mankind was under moral requirements from creation. Mankind was under moral requirements from creation as shown by the fact that people of Noah's day were destroyed for their wickedness. The world was destroyed because of their wickedness. There were moral requirements, but those moral requirements had not, at least for the most part, had not been given as law in the sense that they had not been laid down as specific, express commandments. Rather, they were known intuitively or innately. From the law that God had written on the human heart, they were understood. The law of the heart that Paul refers to in Romans chapter 2, verse 15. But violating those requirements was still sin and punishable as such. In other words, the existence of law in the sense of specific and express commandments to be obeyed is not necessary for sin to occur. The existence of law in that sense of specific and express commandments to be obeyed is not necessary for sin to occur. It's the difference between you knew better than to blank and I specifically told you not to blank. Now, what parent hasn't said to their child, you knew better than, and you hold them accountable for that? Why? Because you knew. You don't have to say, but you didn't say I wasn't supposed to set my sister's hair on fire. You never said that. In fact, it reminds me of a line out of Seinfeld that I won't tell you. But that's why Paul can say in Romans chapter 2, verse 12, for as many as sinned without the law will also perish without the law. And why he can say in Romans chapter 5, verse 13, that sin was in the world before the law was given. He says until, meaning prior to. Sin was in the world before that. Indeed, the Lord said in Genesis chapter 4, verse 7, long before the giving of the Mosaic law, and if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door. Its desire is for you, but you must rule over it. Okay, so this idea, I want you to see that there is sin that exists. Moral requirements exist without a specific and express commandment because they are part of the law that God has placed in the human heart. Transgression, however, that's a different story. See, to transgress is to violate the will of God as revealed in an express commandment. That's what transgression is. Let me read you a few scholars just to show you I'm not making that up. He says, C.B. Cranfield says, the idea contained in these words, transgression and transgressor, as they're used in the New Testament, is that of the transgression of a known, concrete, divine commandment. Douglas Moo says in his commentary on Romans, he says, transgression denotes a specific kind of sin, the passing beyond the limits set by a definite, positive law or command. While every transgression is also a sin, not every sin is a transgression. I mean, you see, transgression is a species of sin. So I think that's an important thing to recognize. So the existence of law in the sense of express commands is a precondition to transgression, but it's not a precondition to sin. Okay? Express commandments, precondition to transgression, but not to sin. And that's what Paul means when he says in Romans 4:15, and where there is not law, neither is there transgression. As Moo points out, he says, Paul in Romans 4:15 is not claiming that there's no sin where there's no law, but in almost a truism that there's no deliberate disobedience of positive commands when there's no positive command to disobey. So that's important to see what I think is going on in 13 and 14. Then you have this statement in 13, for until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not charged when there is no law. When he says that doesn't mean that it's not sin or that it's ignored and not punished. I mean, how could it mean that in light of the Old Testament witness? When you have the flood, I mean, how could that possibly mean that? Rather, it means that without law, sin can't be counted as transgression. It can't be counted as a violation of specific commands and prohibitions. Let me read you a few people on this. Here's a Ben Witherington in his commentary on Romans. He says, Paul, talking about this sin is not charged, your translation may say reckoned, held to account, they vary on how it's translated. Paul cannot mean that God simply ignored sin, since he surely knows the story of Noah. Thus, what Paul seems to mean is that sin was not reckoned as transgression, for the latter involves a willful violation of a known law. Cranfield says, not charged, must be understood in a relative sense. Only in comparison with what takes place when the law is present can it be said that in the law's absence, sin is not charged. Those who live without the law were certainly not innocent sinners. They were to blame for what they were and what they did. But in comparison with the state of affairs which has obtained since the advent of the law, sin may be said to have been in the law's absence, not registered, since it was not the fully apparent, sharply defined thing which it became in its presence. Thomas Schreiner says, how then do we explain verse 13, which says that sin is not reckoned apart from law? The purpose of that verse is to explain that apart from the Mosaic law, sin is not equivalent to transgression. This is confirmed by both Romans 4:15 and the present context, for Paul notes explicitly in 5:14 that Adam's sin was different in kind from those who lived before the Mosaic law, in that he violated a commandment disclosed by God. Now, it's true that prior to the Mosaic law, people did not transgress as did Adam, but they still sinned, and because they sinned, God's judgment of death spread to them in the same way it had come on Adam. Let me read to you Johannes Schneider. This is from the Theological Dictionary of the New Testament. He says, the command which Adam received and transgressed was that he should not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Men who lived in the time between Adam and Moses sinned, but they were not guilty of transgression in the same way as Adam. For in the intervening period, there was no express statement of God's commandment. Hence, sin was present, but not transgression. Okay, that's what I think is being said verses 13 and 14. So in my view, the point of 13 and 14, as I see them, is that the extent of Adam's death-producing effect on humanity. Remember, this is the point. It's an analogy. And what I see him saying is that the extent of Adam's death-producing effect on humanity was not limited or restricted by having skipped over those generations that lived prior to the Mosaic law, as though sin and its accompanying death sentence could only happen when there was law, an express commandment, like Adam had. You see, so he's saying, no. It doesn't require an express commandment as Adam had. So his negative effect on humanity, it didn't skip over all those people so that he doesn't function very well as an analog to Christ. No. They were included. You see, he affected all people. They were included even before the giving of the law. Adam's deadly effect was realized in people sinning, not only in their transgressing, and thus he brought condemnation, he brought judgment death on all mankind, including those prior to the Mosaic law. And again, see, I think that Paul is not discussing the case of infants, the unaccountable, that kind of thing. The death penalty, it reigned over humanity from Adam to Moses because it was God's judgment, God's condemnation on the sin of those generations, which sin is traceable to Adam. Okay? That's what I think. That's the analogy, and that's what I think Paul is saying. Now, that assertion that Paul makes, it follows from what he's already said about the universality of sin and God's penalty for it. And it follows from God's condemnation of sinners in the Old Testament. Paul has made the point, all are under sin. All are under this power, held under this power of sin. He's already said that. Paul has already said that all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And that's a fact that's acknowledged expressly in the Old Testament. That's not something new. There's no one who doesn't sin. You can see that in 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 46, 2 Chronicles chapter 6, verse 36. So that's recognized, and God's judgment against sinners, it was revealed not only in the case of Adam, but it was exhibited and demonstrated in these dramatic events like the flood and the incineration of Sodom and Gomorrah. What do you think God is saying? What is he doing? What is his reaction to sin? Well, he flooded the world. He incinerated Sodom and Gomorrah. So it gives you a good idea of Paul, of God's reaction and his response to sin. The wages of sin is death. Paul will say in Romans chapter 6, verse 23, and that death, judgment death, characterized humanity even before the giving of the Mosaic Law. Adam got everybody. Those who are his own, he got everybody. Now, the fact there were people of faith between Adam and Moses who had the death sentence that had been imposed on them for their sinning, they had that death sentence commuted by the grace of God, Abraham being a prime example. The fact there are such people of faith, that doesn't alter the fact that God's judgment of death spread to all people because all sinned as a result of Adam by way of the transmitted corruption. However you want to understand the transmitted corruption. You see, it doesn't alter that fact. That's all Paul needs. That's all that he needs to make his point that just as there existed a death-producing connection between Adam and his own, so there exists a life-producing connection between Christ and his own. See, judgment death reigned over humanity, despite the fact some were freed from it by faith through the grace of God, which grace, by the way, has now been shown to be rooted and centered in the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the door of God's grace. He is the door of all divine forgiveness. And he has now appeared and been shown to be just that. Okay, so this is what I think that Paul is doing here. Adam's wide effect on mankind is analogous to that of Christ, but there are major differences. And Paul is careful to point those out. So there is this analogy, but it's not on all points. There's the analogy in that just as the death-producing effect, he had that on all people, so Christ has a life-giving effect on those who are his. But there are major differences, and he points those out. Many people died by Adam's trespass. That was his effect on them. Many people died as a result, whereas many people received God's grace through the gift of Christ's act. You see, that's an opposite kind of thing. Right? So, I mean, it's not that Christ is a bearer of death. No. Not at all. That's not it. That's not it at all. Adam's one sin brought condemnation, whereas the gift of Christ's act brought acquittal after many trespasses. Difference. Opposite, reversal. But still the point of how can one man have such a tremendous effect on so many people? Well, Adam had a tremendous effect on those who are his own. So it shouldn't surprise you. It's not something out of the ordinary or without analog. We have that in Adam. He says here that through the disobedience of Adam, the many were made sinners, whereas through the obedience of Jesus, the many will be made righteous. Okay, so there are obviously these differences that Paul's careful to point out. That's not the point of his analogy. But in verse 18, the statement in verse 18 where it says that the justification that leads to life came to all people. Okay, well that means all people in Christ. And you can see in verse 17, because he refers in verse 17 to what? Those who receive the gift. And we see from chapter 1 all the way through chapter 5, that means who is that? That's those who believe. Okay? So it's those who receive the gift. That's who he's referring to when he says that justification that leads to life came to all people. And then in chapter 5, verse 20, Paul says that the Mosaic Law was given not to correct the situation created by Adam, but to make it worse. It was given not to correct it, but to make it worse. The law intensified the power of sin. See, God is doing something here. The law intensified the power of sin by stimulating sinful desire. You'll see that in Romans chapter 7, verse 5, and chapter 7, verse 8. That the giving of the law stimulated this. And it also gave sin this more defined character of transgression. And as Paul makes clear in chapter 7, it is sin, not the law, that's to blame for this. We sometimes give the law a bad rap. But it's sin, not the law, that was to blame for this. Sin used, Paul says, the holy and good law. Holy, righteous, and good. Sin used the holy law against its subjects. You see that in chapter 7, verse 8 and 11 through 14. So that's my picture of Romans chapter. At least if you heard me and you got it, I'm happy with that. You see? If you at least understand how I see it, that's all I can do, and I'm pleased. Okay? Your being here doesn't mean you agree with me. All right? I'm well aware of that. But I just want you to hear how I see it, because I spent a lot of time thinking about it, and so I naturally think it's worth you hearing. So, but you weigh it, and so I've done the best I can to articulate it. And I think that's what Paul is saying, or I wouldn't be saying it. But I'm fallible. I know that comes as a surprise. Okay, here we go. Romans chapter 6. You never thought we'd get there. What then should we, 6 to 14. What then shall we say? Should we continue in sin so that grace may increase? Absolutely not. We who died to sin, how shall we still live in it? Or do you not know that as many as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we were buried together with him through baptism into his death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so also we might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with the likeness of his death, then also we will be united with the likeness of his resurrection, knowing that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be nullified, that we might no longer serve sin as slaves. For the one who died has been pronounced righteous from sin. Quite a bit of discussion about how that phrase should be translated. It normally means pronounced righteous. Some think here it ought to have the nuance of freed. Okay, so your translation may say that. For the one who died has been pronounced righteous from sin. But if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. Knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, no longer dies, death no longer exercises lordship over him. For what he died to sin once and for all. But what he lives to God. So also you must consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but living to God in Christ Jesus. Do not then let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its passions, nor present your members to sin as weapons of unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those living from the dead, and your members to God as weapons of righteousness. For sin will not exercise lordship over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. All right, this is now, John sends me text every morning before the class, every Sunday, and tells me to preach it, you see. And some things, like I tell him in Romans 5, that's just more gnarly kind of trying to work through and trying to give you something. Now, when you get to this, you see, where Paul is saying, listen, this is how you are to be as a Christian. He says, look, he has just said at the end of chapter 5 that grace superabounded in the face of the increase of sin that was occasioned by the law in chapter 5, verse 20. Okay, sin increased, but what? Grace superabounded in the face of the increase of sin as it's stimulated and it's intensified into transgression. It's acting more. He says, well, in the face of that, grace superabounded. Well, having said that, some might think Paul is implying that we should remain in sin. We should remain under sin's control so that grace may increase. I mean, God's in the grace business, right? If by being trapped in sin, as the sin intensifies and increases, the response is grace superabounded, well, man, that sounds like a good opportunity to let God be glorified by showing his super, super abounding grace. And so that Paul is saying that some might have that idea and some might think that. And if that sounds odd to you, you recall in chapter 3, verse 8, where Paul said, "Why not also say, as we're being blasphemed, and as some claim we say, let us do evil so that good may come." Okay, so he's already mentioned this is something somebody's saying about him. No. Let's do evil so that good may come. And as in chapter 3, verse 8, Paul here, he summarily rejects the idea as absurd. He declares, absolutely not. Insane. Absurd. The answer is no way that that even comes close to being true. It is totally inconsistent for Christians. Those who have died to sin, meaning those who have died to sin's detriment. Those who have died and been separated from sin's power, who have died to sin's disadvantage, to sin's loss. See, those who've died to sin's detriment, it is inconsistent for them to continue to live under sin's control. Isn't that crazy? If I have died to sin's detriment, if I have been separated from sin's power, so that here it is, I die and it's now, you know, and I want to live under its control? He said, well, that's absolutely ridiculous. You see, to continue to do that, to think otherwise is to ignore the fact that our sharing in Christ's death through baptism was so that we, like Christ, might rise from that death to walk, he says, in newness of life. To walk in newness of life. This is something, a theme that Terry's been trying to get us to awaken to, the notion that Christianity ends when I somehow get baptized and, okay, my sins have been forgiven, that's it. That's insane. Okay? He says it nicer than that. I'll just tell you, that's insane. Okay, we rise to walk in newness of life as redeemed people. This is a beginning of an entirely new existence in a new realm, in a new sphere. We walk in newness of life, and it's a life that's marked by the realities of the new age, especially the power of God's Spirit. Paul is going to say in Romans chapter 7, he's going to talk about that. In Romans chapter 7, verse 6, all of chapter 8. So here is Christ rises to a new state or era of his messianic work. Death no longer has purchase on him. Death no longer has any reach on him. He has died, and now death is no longer exercises. So he's in a new state and a new situation. And that's how it is for us. This is a tremendous climactic change. For somebody to come out of the baptistry, having confessed Jesus Christ and become a Christian, and to think that life goes on as it did before, no. You have been taken now to an entirely new state. An entirely new state. And you are to walk in newness of life, a life that is characterized by the new age. You see, when Christ comes and brings the kingdom, this pulling in of the not yet. You see, the power of the Spirit, and how are we to be, and what is eternity? And so that has invaded the now, and we are participating in that ahead of the consummation. So for us to live in sin, having died to its detriment, having been freed from its power, and then to talk about sin, oh, you know, I just sin. Look, we have to do better than that. We have to recognize what this is, and we have to live in a way that reflects it. For if we've been conformed to Christ's death in baptism, we will also be conformed to his resurrection life. If we've been conformed to his death in baptism, if we have in faith and repentance come and confess Christ, been buried with Christ in baptism, we will be conformed to his resurrection life. We know that our old man was crucified with Jesus. Our old man was crucified with Jesus in our sharing in the death that he died for all. And that old man is the man under the old age, the man under the tyranny of sin and death. That's who that old man is. As John Stott writes, he says, "What was crucified was not part of me called my old nature, but the whole of me as I was before I was converted." You see, the old man is the one that exists in Adam, and the new man is the one who exists in Christ. So here I was in Adam, part of his own, judged, condemned, under death, and I've now come to belong to Christ. I'm now part of his own. So as Adam had that horrible negative effect, now Christ, all who are his, what do they have? They have grace and peace and life and transformation. And so this is what Paul is talking about. So this verse, and Colossians chapter 3, verses 9 and 10, they make clear that the Christian has ceased to be old man and has become new man. But then Ephesians chapter 4, verses 22 to 24, it commands Christians to put off the old man and to put on the new man. That'll make you scratch your head a little bit. I mean, you know, you go, well, so what's this about? What does this mean? See, and I think what Paul is talking about, the way to understand these things, and I'm not the only one, of course, that thinks this, says as long as we live in this overlap of ages before the consummation at Christ's return, the new man in Christ continues to be subjected to the influences of the old age because it's an overlap, right? The new age is broken in, but it's not the sole reality. So what happens? There's sin and pressure and hostility and pull and temptation and death and sorrow and all those things. So in this overlap of ages, we're subject to the powers of the old age, and we have to continually resist them. In other words, we must live like the new creation we are. Old man's gone, new man's here, put off the old man, put on the new man, live consistently with who you are. Live consistently with who you are. I heard that bell, last line. Douglas Moo puts it, he says, what we were in Adam is no more, but until heaven, the temptation to live in Adam always remains. And there's not a Christian who can't recognize that and say, yes, I know that, but you and I are called to something much higher. I heard that bell. Thanks for being here.